In any case, the news is not good about pandemics, but you and I are part of the alt news media, alternative viewpoint. Yes. And you have your channel and I have got my channel, and we'll both be putting this out on our channels because we really need, especially now, desperately need to educate people. And what I'm saying is we need to get them to connect the dots between the current coronavirus outbreak and climate change.
Exactly. Yeah. Yes. And also in the really short term, you know, immediate term, we need to, countries are making mistakes left, right, and center.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, they're not, you know, and the difference between acting and locking down a country, shutting it down basically one day to the next, can make an enormous difference on the outcome because of the rapidity of this virus. Just saying, the UK and the US are in deep, deep trouble because the UK is talking about herd immunity, which is absolutely insane. You know, this is Boris Johnson's view. You know,
herd just, community. What do you mean?
Herd immunity. Herd immunity. He's saying, you know, let the thing come and do its damage on us, and then, you know, a lot of us will get immunity to it. We'll get infected. We'll get immunity. We'll survive, and then it will be out of our system quickly.
Insane.
Which is insane. I mean, people talk about herd immunity with vaccinations, right? If you vaccinate a certain number of people, then that protects all the people that are that can't get vaccinated, because there's not enough carriers for it to keep spreading in the population. So, but that applies to when people are immune, you know, given vaccines. But if nobody's got, we don't have vaccines for this. So it would require about 60% of the population to be infected before the other 40% would be less likely to become infected, which is crazy because there's no modulation of the spike. So, you know, once the hospitals get flooded you know, then it's over. Like in the U.S. is
let me jump ahead though. I want to go again into connecting the dots, like I did talking in my last conversation. Why would, and I ask you, and you'll know right away because you know who I am and what my incessant message is.
Yeah.
Bottom line, root cause. Why would governments be motivated to not act correctly and do lockdowns? Why?
Yeah.
In one word.
Yeah. Well, they care about the money. They don't care about the
bingo money
about people, right?
But the, you know, you can say
money is a good spreader too, right? Local coffee shops in Ottawa. I'm in Oshawa right now, but local coffee shops, they're only accepting debit or credit because money, you know, if you're handling money, you've got the virus, the virus will get on the money.
Everywhere. You want somebody to stick their card in, they handle the come, they get it.
Yes, that's right.
Or you have a little bit of the hand sanitizer next to it, but I got it. Well, that's a sane reason.
Think about it. You know, another thing that people really need to be aware of is, okay, you're on your phone doing stuff, right? And I can't bring out my phone because it's filming for us on a tripod. You bring out your phone, you're doing all kinds of stuff. Then you go to the washroom and wash your hands with soap. You know, soap is way better. And then you go back and you start eating, and then you bring your phone out and you start doing stuff. It's no good. What's the good of washing your hands if you don't also wash the screen of your phone?
Yeah, you can't. I understand. I have not started, I have not gotten it until today that I really need to start washing my hands. But I just held this up in case, in the remote possibility that anybody listening to this does not understand that this is a communicator. Now, this will add a little bit of information to your panoply of information. The conversation I just had with Raymond Ford, he said that apparently this novel coronavirus is polar in nature. What do you mean, Raymond? Polar in nature. That is, it's got a charge polarity. And he said human beings actually have a positive charge that throughout our body, if you added it all together, it's maybe 30,000 volts. Now, yeah, but this was from a scientist, you know, albeit a self-taught mass spectrometrist. But he, what he said was that the virus will cling to metallic surfaces more than it will cling to wood or paper or other or fabric, other things. And because the metal will do that exchange of electrons that makes it very sticky. So if somebody infected, say on a cruise ship, is touching a handrail, looking over the side of the cruise ship, then the next person who comes along, they got it. And the next person who comes along, they got it too.
Yeah, I just, you probably haven't seen them yet. I just put out two videos about 3 or 4 hours ago, and I talked about the detailed, it's called the macromolecular chemistry of the virus. So the virus is, the diameter is about 50 to 200 nanometers. That's a billion, a nanometer is a billionth of a meter. That's the size, the diameter. To put that in perspective, a human hair, ouch, is about 50 to 100 microns or micrometers, which is a millionth of a meter. So the virus, you know, pull out your hair, look at the thickness of it. The diameter of the virus is about 1,000 times smaller.
1,000 times smaller.
1,000 times smaller. So, you know, when you think of a surface, a surface that we see as perfectly smooth would be quite rough to the virus, but metal, not so much. And the hydrogen bonds actually, you know, it's very sticky. It's like a nanoparticle of there's three main components. The RNA, ribonucleic acid, the actual virus component, is on the inside. And then there's a lipid or fat layer on the outside. And then there's some protein molecules that help it get into cells of our body, et cetera. So those are three components. It's not alive. You have those components together, and they call it, the virologists, they call it self-assembly. So you have those components together, and then it self-assembles into the form of the virus. It's not alive.
If I can repeat that.
That's right.
I want to feed it back to you, because my function here is to take your knowledge and repeat it so that people will understand it, okay? Right. I mean, not that they couldn't understand what you said.
Yeah, but putting it in other words is good.
Yeah, right? I want to put it in other words. So if I understand you correctly, the genetic part, the thing by which the virus does damage in your body, and the RNA is, most people know DNA is a double
DNA. Helix,
double-stranded helix. RNA is one of those two. If you could take DNA and tear it apart.
Yes.
But the RNA can do damage because it can insert itself into cells in your body.
Right.
And then co-opt your DNA to reproduce itself. Okay.
Yes.
That's number one. That's what the RNA is. That's the payload, the damaging payload.
Yes.
You say that's surrounded by a lipid layer, which is fat. So it's the sac that contains that is like a fatty sac. Okay.
Yeah, think of grease or something, a grease ball or a little oil slick or something.
A little grease balls. Okay. And poking through that, because when you see pictures of the coronavirus, there are these little spikes on the outside. Yeah. Those are the proteins by which it finds receptors to grab onto.
Exactly. And that's where the name is, corona. Like corona is crown. So, you know, it kind of looks like a crown, the spikes coming out. I don't think it looks much like a crown, but
somebody named it and it stuck.
Yeah, that's right.
It stuck. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
So good. Okay. So now we've explained to people what the coronavirus is, and it's funny because you don't get that on the news.
Soap is also a polar molecule. Mm-hmm. So you know what these molecules they have a side that loves water, like it's called hydrophilic, and that side that loves water hates oils and grease. Yeah. And then the other side of the molecule is the opposite. It's hydrophobic. It hates water and it loves oils. So when you use soap on your hands, the molecules actually latch on, the side of the molecule, soap molecule that loves fat, latches on to the fatty part of the virus. The water part gets pulled out towards the rest of the water in the solution. So soap basically annihilates, it rips, it annihilates, it pulls apart the virus. So all of the
pieces pull apart the virus, or does it just kind of absorb the viruses and flush them?
Well, no, it doesn't just go down the drain. The virus is totally annihilated and destroyed. Everything is broken apart. That's why soap is so effective. The chemical reaction takes, it takes a few seconds. You have to wash to get into all the pores. So any virus that's lodged in your skin pores is removed. But also you need that time for the chemical reaction to take place. So 20 seconds is crucial.
Okay. In the last conversation, we came up with an interesting idea. Raymond came up with it, and I've modified it a bit. He said,
right,
if you don't know what 20 seconds is, then sing happy birthday to yourself and, you know, hum it.
And I have a different song instead of happy birthday, right? I say the Serenity Prayer in that 20 seconds.
What is the
which goes, it goes, dear Lord, you can leave the dear Lord off. You know, please grant me the serenity to accept the things that I cannot change, the courage to change the things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference.
You know who that saying comes from?
It's ancient, but I'm not sure who it comes from.
Well, if it's ancient, then I don't know either. But within the last century, it was said and became famous through one of the justices, and it may have been a chief justice of the American Supreme Court.
Okay. I think he borrowed it from, I think it goes back, many hundreds of years, but, you know, we can check that.
I'm glad you brought that up. I'm glad you stated the way you did, because I like to point out that what we do, even though it's mostly science, we are grounded in the idea that faith, the invisible, is as important as science. You know, your intention, your prayer, all of those, your ethical stature, which cannot be measured scientifically. Measured statistically, we would know that we have a president in the United States that scores near zero on the scale of ethics.
I mean, there's a lot of ironies here. I mean, you and I, we've been concerned about climate for years. Climate is rapidly accelerating. We're in abrupt change. We're getting all kinds of things. And then this virus comes along, and in about 2 weeks or 3 weeks or 2 months, 3 months, spreads around the world, and people are emptying shelves and panicking. Yeah. Whereas with the climate thing, they just don't get it yet.
And that I've explained several times, so let me put it in here so that that our video editor, Mika, in Finland can, I should not identify him, but I shouldn't identify anybody on our team, in case one of the bad players wants to weaken our approach.
Organization.
No, I'm losing my thread.
So the idea that we've been worried about climate. Yeah. Most people think climate's long term.
Okay. So and you got it right there. We're responding to the coronavirus, to this pandemic, in a way that we respond to fire and flood. It's an immediate existential threat to us individually. Whereas climate, it's always, and the media, the mass media, does us no favors by continually talking about 2100, that ocean rise by, because nobody gets excited about that. What do I care? I'll be dead.
And also,
even 2050 doesn't do it.
Yeah. And also the numbers, like the temperature changes. You know, if in the morning I can wake up and it could be minus 10 and it can go to plus 5. I'm talking Celsius. You could do the conversion. But anyway, there's a large range of temperature in a given day, you know, and it's even larger in seasons and throughout the year. And when we talk about 2 degrees or 3 degrees global average temperature rise, you know, people think, well, it changes 20 in a day. So how does 2 to 3 degrees make any difference? They don't realize that 5 degrees is an ice age versus a warm period.
Well, but it's more insidious because even though we can tolerate a 2 degree change, say, the foods, plants, and animals that we depend upon cannot necessarily. Yeah. I mean, between in Fahrenheit, a healthy person is about 98.5 degrees.
Yes.
A person who is soon going to die if they don't get chilled is at 105 degrees. So there's a differential there of maybe 6.5 degrees Fahrenheit, which the equivalent in Celsius would be about 3 degrees.
Right, which is in a different, you know, life and death in your human body system. But the interesting thing is, I mean, you, like, everybody learns 98.6, right? Core body temperature, which is 37 Celsius. But that study from a century ago indicated those numbers. A more recent study with a huge number of people found out that the core body temperature is no longer 98.6.
What is it?
It's something like 97.8 or something.
Yeah.
Now, so we're actually, it's a fascinating thing because it means that we're evolving, you know, in some way in a century. It also means that the wet bulb temperature of 35 Celsius, 100% humidity, is going to be a little bit lower, right? Because the reason why that 35... I'll stick to Celsius, but you get the idea. So if your body temperature is 37, core body temperature.
I'm sorry, let me just interject. This part of the conversation is striking me as too arcane to be.
Probably, but it's just interesting that you know, because it's the skin temperature that's important for sweating and losing heat from your body from sweating. And that's a bit low. That's 35 as opposed to 37. Like the core temperature is a couple of degrees warmer, you know, and you can do the conversion in Fahrenheit. But, you know, it is relevant because, of course, the virus, you know, you get a fever. And when you have a fever, you know, if your core temperature is slightly higher, it should be easier for you to shed off heat, right? So the reason why you get a fever is, you know, it gives your body more of a fighting chance to get rid of, like, to shed off heat.
And that was also the way I think about it is because the pathogens cannot survive. They also have an optimal temperature range. Yes. And if your body gets hot, then often that will kill the bacteria, say. Viruses are not the same though, I don't think.
Yes. No, they're not. But that's a good point. Yes.
Yeah. Anyhow, so I will thank you. Yeah. I will. This is the second conversation I've had today, which said 20 seconds, and I am horrible about washing my hands, even under optimal conditions, but I will.
Yes.
You hear that, folks? Wash your hands.